Let's investigate the normality assumption in pooled variance t procedures. This video looks at the effect of a violation of the normality assumption on the pooled variance t, and the results for the Welch unpooled variance t are very similar. Here are the assumptions of the pooled variance t procedures. The pooled variance t procedures require independent simple random samples from the populations of interest, and this is always important even if we have large sample sizes. It also requires equal population variances, and this is also always important, even if we have large sample sizes. And I looked at the effect of a violation of the equal variance assumption in detail in another video. It also requires normally distributed populations, and this video will investigate the effect of a violation of the normality assumption on the effectiveness of these procedures. The procedures will work well for large sample sizes, even for non-normal populations. But what is the effect of a violation of the normality assumption for smaller sample sizes? The two sample t procedures are quite robust to violations of the normality assumption, more so than the one sample procedures. This means that the two sample procedures work well in a lot of different situations, even when the normality assumption is violated. When constructing a confidence interval for mu1 minus mu2, what are the consequences if the normality assumption is violated? The short version is that the true confidence level will be different from the stated confidence level. We might be stating a 95% confidence interval, but that interval method might only capture the true difference in means a much lower percentage of the time, like 91% or 89%. If we were carrying out a hypothesis test and the normality assumption is violated, then the true significance level would differ from the stated significance level. Let's investigate the effect of a violation of the normality assumption using simulation. Here are the four distributions used in the simulations in this video, representing different shapes of distribution. We have a normal distribution, a uniform, an exponential, and a distribution that's quite a bit like the normal except with heavier tails. One point to note here is that all of these distributions have been scaled to make the variance of every distribution equal, so the common variance assumption is true in every case. Here we are simply investigating the effect of the shape of the distribution. In these simulations, we're going to draw 100,000 samples for every pair of these distributions for various sample sizes. For each pair of samples, we are going to calculate a 95% confidence interval for mu1 minus mu2. Then we will ask ourselves this question. What percentage of these intervals captures the true value of mu1 minus mu2? And if this percentage is close to 95%, the procedure works well in that scenario. Here are some of the results. First, note right away that the difference x1 bar minus x2 bar, the difference in sample means in every one of these situations, is an unbiased estimator of this difference in population means. On average, the difference in sample means equals the difference in population means for all of these different distributions. It's just that the margin of error isn't quite right for non-normal populations. To keep this video at a manageable length, I'm going to look only at the equal sample size situation, with sample sizes of 5, 10, and 50. And we'll see that as those sample sizes increase, the effect of a violation of the normality assumption is not as bad. And for the unequal sample size situation, the situation is usually a little bit better than if they both had the smaller sample size. For example, the effect of a violation of the normality assumption is usually a little worse if both sample sizes are 5 than if one is 5 and one is 12, say. We're going to look at a variety of situations in this video. At first, population 1 will have a normal distribution, and population 2 will also have a normal distribution. We will then let population 2 have different distributions and see what happens. Here, when both populations are normal, these percentages, which we might call the estimated coverage percentages of our confidence interval method, are very close to 95%. We have 95.1% and 94.9%. Theoretically, the percentages are equal to exactly 95% for all sample sizes. But there's still a little variability here. We only took 100,000 pairs of samples, so we're not going to get exactly 95% in our simulation. So when the normality assumption is met, the procedure works very well. Well, we knew that going in, so that's not all that interesting. But what happens when the normality assumption is violated? Here, population 1 is still normal, but population 2 is uniform. And we can see that these estimated coverage percentages are close to 95%, even for small sample sizes. So the procedure works very well here. Here, we're incorporating some skewness in population 2 with the exponential distribution. If you recall, one sample T procedures do not work very well for small sample sizes when there's strong skewness. But here, in the two sample T procedures, it's not a major problem if one of the populations has some skewness. What if population 2 has heavier tails than a normal distribution? Here we're sampling from the distribution given in blue, which has slightly heavier tails than the normal distribution. That has a slight negative effect here, with these coverage percentages a little bit lower than 95%. Now let's investigate what happens when both populations are not normal. Here, population 1 is uniform, and population 2 has one of these other distributions. And, for the first simulation, we're going to look at the case where population 2 also has a uniform distribution. If we look up here at these percentages, we see that the T procedure is still working quite well when both populations are uniform, even for small sample sizes. If one is uniform and one is exponential, it seems to be a little bit worse here, with the coverage percentage at 94% for very small sample sizes, but it quickly moves towards 95% as the sample sizes increase. And if population 2 has heavier tails than the normal distribution, then the situation isn't too bad either. These percentages are pretty close to 95%, even for small sample sizes. How about if both populations have an exponential distribution? Here, the coverage percentages are actually a little bit greater than 95%. We see 96.1% when the two sample sizes are 5. But again, the coverage percentages tend towards 95% as the sample sizes increase. If one is exponential and the other has heavier tails than the normal distribution, the situation appears to be a little bit worse, with the coverage percentages down to 93.6% for sample sizes of 5. But again, it moves up towards 95% pretty quickly, and even 93.6% isn't too bad. Let's look at one last situation, one where there is skewness but in opposite directions in the two populations. Here, population 1 has an exponential distribution, and population 2 has the same distribution but flipped over with left skewness. This is not a distribution that we would expect to see too often, but it illustrates the point that if the skewness is in opposite directions, the procedures can perform poorly. This is the worst percentage we saw in all of the simulations, so the procedure's not working very well here. But again, as the sample sizes increase, it's less and less of a problem. The good news is that a situation like this is very unlikely to arise in practice. We're not typically comparing populations that have vastly different shapes like this. Let's look at a few notes. The pooled variance T procedures work well in a variety of situations. The two sample T procedures are far more robust to violations of the normality assumption than one sample T procedures. You may recall that in one sample T procedures, some violations of the normality assumption had much more negative consequences. A violation of the normality assumption is typically much less of a problem than a violation of the common variance assumption. A violation of the common variance assumption sometimes has extremely negative consequences. Because of the relationship between hypothesis tests and confidence intervals, very similar results hold for pooled variance T tests as well. And very similar results hold for Welch unpooled T tests and confidence intervals. I've run the simulations, but I'm not showing them here. It's a wise idea to check to see if the normality assumption is reasonable before carrying out the T procedures, and I recommend doing so by plotting a normal quantile-quantile plot. Some people recommend doing a test on normality, but that's not my preferred approach. And it's not all about the T procedures. The T procedures are very useful tools, but there are other options. For example, some statistical procedures applicable in the situations we looked at in this video, such as the Mann-Whitney-U test, do not require normally distributed populations, and may work better than the pooled variance t-test in some of these scenarios.